Now, Minister Hoskins has mentioned access and equity as the two key principles that are driving transformation in Ontario. He's also talked about the importance of addressing the social determinants of health. He stressed the importance of the needs of marginalized people, essentially, again, the clientele that you serve in your member centers. But of course, the devil is in the details for doing all this. So how does the planning begin? How do you roll out changes? Our next speaker is someone who has the challenging job of answering those questions, of developing some of those devilish details. So let me introduce Lynn Guerriero. She's a brand new Assistant Deputy Minister of Health and Long-Term Care, and one of her portfolios is guiding the transformation of the primary care, primary health care system. So Lynn took this position just 5 months ago, and prior to joining government, she spent 6 years at Cancer Care Ontario, working her way up to managing director. She's gonna give us a brief overview of some of the ministry's plans that will take us to the next phase of primary care's evolution in Ontario. So Lynn, please take the stage.
Thank you, André. Just make sure I have the buttons down here. Got it. So thank you for inviting me to speak today and for being a part of this very important conversation. I would just like to echo my thanks after Minister Hoskins. Thank you to everyone in the room and your colleagues for the tremendous work that you do. I've only been at the Ministry of Health for almost 5 months. However, have spent my career in healthcare. I've never actually worked in the primary care sector. And so over the last sort of 4.5 months, I've had the opportunity to engage with many of you and your colleagues. And I've been incredibly impressed with the work that has gone on thus far in what I would call primary care reform or transformation. And so I really welcome the opportunity to be a part of your club and for being a part of this very important conversation today. So in the next 15 minutes or so, what I'd like to do is bring you some information on the direction the ministry is taking. And I would call it on the continuing journey of strengthening primary care in Ontario. And I just want to start by highlighting the government's commitment. And you just heard Minister Hoskins speak of some of the things he's committed to. I just want to highlight for you some of the words in several sort of speeches and documents, and particularly the mandate letter that he has before him and that we are working fast and furiously to help him implement. So just to notice with the slide in front of you, guaranteeing that every Ontarian has a primary care provider, that we have appropriate and expanded scope of practice for providers and more models for collaborative care. He is committed to bring forward a plan to ensure every Ontarian who wants one has a primary care provider. So you'll hear this theme repeated, and it's something that we are taking very seriously. Care that is appropriately coordinated around the person receiving it, especially for those who are transitioning through and across systems and sectors. So you'll hear me talk a little bit about our hope to have primary care as the foundation of our healthcare system. I think we would all agree that that's the role it should have, and it's perhaps not one that we've supported in the past. Continuing to drive accountability, transparency, and quality. But what's important to note here is limiting expenditure growth. And I think those of you who deal with us on a regular basis will know that we are in a bit of an environment of fiscal restraint. And then just under the action plan, Patients First, together with our partners, we will bring forward a plan to ensure our primary care providers are organized around the needs of the population. Critically important. And we know that the population in Ontario is not a homogeneous one. And so really important that we don't think of the population of Ontario, but very much a regional look and a community level look at populations that are quite different. So I just want to take a moment to look back a little bit, and how are we characterizing what's in front of us now going forward? And it would be inaccurate to say that we are launching some type of primary care reform. And I'm sure nobody wants to hear that. Much has already been accomplished since 2003. And I'm sure everyone here can think of some tremendous success stories that have occurred throughout the province. So if you think back to prior to 2003, you'll know that there was a shortage of family physicians. We had many patients without a provider. For the most part, we had a fee-for-service model, and many, and almost all, solo private practice physicians. And then in 2003, which we sort of call the beginning of primary care reform, you'll know that there was efforts to increase the number of family physicians, and many more patients were attached to a provider. And really, it was the beginning of team-based comprehensive care. When we talk about primary care, I think it's important to acknowledge the introduction of health links, and hopefully you'll get an opportunity to talk a little bit about that during the conference. And I don't think I need to describe what health links are to this group. I think it's noteworthy that although primary care was not tasked as a sector to lead health links, I think many primary care leaders stepped up and led them. And some would argue that those are some of the best performing health links that we have right now in Ontario. I think it's important to acknowledge the existence of health links and their evolution when we talk about primary care, because we will talk about those most complex patients, the patients that need the best coordination of care, that need sort of that quarterback looking out for them and navigating the system for them. And health links is really designed to do that. So where are we now? Well, we have a much greater number of patients attached. As you can see there, a huge number of interprofessional teams, all of you in the room, and we have 69 health links across the province. So just to level set here, you know, why is this work so critical and of a high priority to us? Well, really foundationally, if we're going to believe that primary care is indeed the entry point to the healthcare system for most people, we know that jurisdictions with high-performing primary healthcare sectors are associated with improved health equity and better overall health system performance. And what I've just said, and I'll repeat it, primary care is the foundation of our healthcare system. And it's critical to the health and wellness of Ontarians, and it is also a critical support to ensuring sustainability of our healthcare system overall. So without a strong primary care system, we're going to have trouble down the road with sustainability. I'll also add that we must have a strong and high-performing and accountable primary care sector if we're to be successful with other critical components of the patient's first strategy. And most notably there, I'll just mention the modernization of home and community care. Can't really do one without the other, I would suggest. So tremendous achievements and an acknowledgement that primary care is the foundation to high-performing, patient-centered healthcare system. But more needs to be done to get us there, and I think that we would all agree. So we need to improve how the sector is organized, we need to improve sector performance, and we need to ensure that the needs of the populations are met. And as I've just said, we're talking about very heterogeneous populations across the province and even heterogeneous within certain urban areas. So right now, we could suggest that cost and performance are not aligned. So you can see here that this is the Commonwealth Fund survey, and you'll see that Ontario's performance here on same-day, next-day access, as well as ease of accessing after-hours care, is really not, we're not performing where we should be benchmarked against our peers. And we're also not performing well as we could on domains that are most important to patients. And I don't think it would surprise anyone here to see what's most important to patients. And I don't think that these are numbers that we necessarily should be proud of. I think that these are numbers that, although we've done a tremendous piece of work to improve, there's still a lot of work we need to do. So to that end, as most of you know, we convened an expert advisory panel back in 2013. They deliberated for about a year. So I don't think I don't think we should go forward and talk about primary care without acknowledging the existence of this expert panel. And I know that there's been lots of talk about their work and about the report that they've recently delivered to us. And this group was co-chaired by David Price. He is a primary care provider, is a physician. And Elizabeth Baker, a nurse practitioner, also a primary care provider. The expert panel had a number of people from across the health sector who really left their affiliation at the door and delivered on a piece of work as the leaders that they are and the experts that they are. And this slide just basically shows you some of the areas that they deliberated on and some of the outcomes of that report. And I would say that what we are doing now is taking that report, the advice of the expert panel, and also several other inputs to start deliberating on how we will then move forward with continuing to strengthen primary care. So we can talk a little bit about that. So here's sort of the, I would say, key elements that we're looking to address. So access and equity, so ensuring that all Ontarians have equitable access to primary care based on the needs of patients, families, and communities. So essentially a commitment that all Ontarians who wish to have a primary care provider will have one. Key here, local management. So integration of primary care services with the rest of the health system and improve integration through local planning and collaboration. And I think, in order for us to really hold primary care, what I'll say, accountable for being the foundation of our health system, they have to be working within the rest of the system, whether that's hospitals, whether that's community and home care, et cetera. Population health need. So implement a risk-adjusted population-based model of resourcing that will align with regions and communities to ensure that primary care services meet the needs of the local population. So you've just heard Minister Hoskins speak of this, but really looking at allocating our resources based on the health needs and the needs of the population. So things like demographics, geography and rurality, socioeconomic status, and then projected health needs of the population into the future. Performance measurement. So really looking to improve performance by establishing very clear, very transparent performance requirements, and then implementing mechanisms that are publicly reported and monitored at both the local and provincial level. And I think we've seen other areas in healthcare and in the province where this step in, coming up with the best metrics, looking at high quality data, and actually giving the public access to that performance data, that in and of itself is a tremendous step forward in improving performance. Some examples of what we might look at that the expert panel contemplated, and none of this will be a surprise to you, but things like the extent to which persons who are visiting the ED are doing so for conditions that ought to be managed elsewhere, such as in primary care, things like follow-up visits with a primary care provider within 7 days of discharge from hospital, and then 30-day readmission rates. And we know that some of those metrics, let's take 30-day readmission rates, for example, are right now really hospital-focused, but in fact, probably need to be looked at from the hospital performance perspective, but most definitely the performance of primary care. And then contract and funding reform. So we couldn't take on this work without looking at all of the contracts and the many versions of payment models that we currently have, and really taking a look to make sure that they are aligned appropriately with the outcomes that we wish to achieve. So let's talk a little bit about complex patients, because I know that that's something that you're interested in, and I won't go into detail on this, but really this is just how we might envision this, and this is how I like to look at it. If we look at the current state, and that sort of top 1 to 5% that we've talked about are those very complex patients that we need to be able to manage based on their needs, and then as we go down, the rest of the population in the pyramid, and looking at the quite fragmented way right now that let's say a population sitting in a certain community would be managed. Very fragmented, and perhaps there's a health link for that 1 to 5%, perhaps there's not. Perhaps it's a high-performing health link, perhaps it's not. It's kind of a shot in the dark. And if we look at the end state that we might achieve, we've got more so a group of primary care providers, in whatever model they're practicing in, collectively accountable for the health and the health care services of a defined population. We can see that there's still that top 1 to 5%, but we can envision a group of primary care providers where there is an associated health link that it's easy to be rostered to, and there's clear and accountable case management for those people in the 1 to 5% and the people that are below that we wish to not get there into the 1 to 5%. So very careful coordination, I think, is a fundamental element of the model. So what would it look like for a patient? What's going to be different? So really simply stated, simple access to a primary care provider roster. If you wish to have one, you will have a primary care provider. There will be a simple way to do it. When required, facilitated access to a health link in my community. Same day, next day access to appointments. Coordination across specialists diagnostics, and home and community care, and in that I would include hospital stays. So really, who's accountable for making sure that all those pieces are linked together? I would like to suggest it's primary care. I think probably the primary care sector would like it to be them. They just need to have the tools available to them. Access to the interprofessional team member who can best meet my needs, and timely access to my health information for all members of my care team. And I don't think it would be a conference where we can't sort of point the finger at our electronic health records and make a plug to actually have them up and running and accessible to not only all members of the care team, but patients. So next steps, so we are currently considering the recommendations of the expert panel, as well as many other inputs, and I really hope to hear lots of good feedback today in a few of the different sessions you're having in order to move forward with this work. And the devil's in the details, of course, and we need to do a pretty detailed plan to get there. And as the work continues, we'll be continuing to engage you. And I would just close by saying that we really need you for this. We cannot do this without you. We really need champions in the field, and I kind of know who a lot of them are. In my first 4 months, I've definitely met a few of you, but we need champions in the field, and we really need thought leaders to help us. This is not something we're going to sit in an office and cook up. This is something that the sector needs to be heavily involved in. And hopefully we will eventually get to that end state we described. So I will leave it there, and I don't think I'm taking questions. I think I'm just sitting down, right?
Thanks, Lynn. We'll have some questions for you in a minute. We'll let you catch your breath. Right now, we want to get some research into the mix. So I want to invite up Dr. Jeremy Petch. He's a writer and editor of Healthy Debate. And he's also the manager of special projects at Li Ka-shing Knowledge Institute at St. Mike's Hospital. And he's going to talk to us a bit about some research about reducing health disparities and the importance of that for the health system. Jeremy?
Thanks, André. André admitted that I'm also a board member of the Regent Park Community Health Center, so CHC power. So I've been asked to talk to you about research I recently published with colleagues at the Public Health Ontario and the University of Toronto, which document the socioeconomic drivers of high-cost use of the healthcare system. And I know many of us are not super fond of the terms high-cost use or high-cost users because it does seem to imply some sort of blame. That's not intended here. I'm just using the language that we've inherited. I think we all together do need to come up with better language to describe the top 1 in 5% of users that acknowledges, as I think the research I'm going to present to you suggests, that that use is really driven by broader social factors that need to be addressed. So my colleagues and I came to this problem about 2 years ago because of concern that Ontario's approach to addressing high-cost use of the healthcare system was at the time exclusively focused on people who were already high-cost users. And you can think of that at the beginning of HealthLinks, what we were hearing a lot of was, go and identify the people who you know are currently your high-cost users of the system. And that's an important thing to do, and I don't want any of what I'm gonna say to suggest that I don't support the work of HealthLinks. I do, I think it's essential. What this research is meant to do is to supplement and talk about what else do we need besides HealthLinks to have a comprehensive wraparound approach to addressing primary health care in this province. So our concern was that we were looking already at people who were very, very sick. And we believed that if Ontario was really going to tackle this problem of high-cost use of the healthcare system, we had to get serious about prevention. But that prevention in general and social determinants in health are just not a meaningful part of the conversation too frequently. Or rather, we hear reference to them, but then when the plans come out, we rarely see them as part of the kind of action plans that we're going to take. And I think many of you probably observed that again in the first wave of HealthLinks and how few primary care, and particularly how few community-governed primary care organizations were part of that first wave of HealthLinks, something that has been corrected and I think has been really important to see change. So I'm not going to go into great depth about research methods. I know that's not why I'm here. I just want to tell you two very brief things, though, about the approach to the research I'm going to describe that I think is important. So one of the key things is that we didn't look at people who were already high-cost users of the healthcare system. Instead, we looked at people who were not high-cost users, the other 95%, so that we could understand what were the factors that led somebody from the 95% to eventually become one of the 1% or the 5%. What were the drivers behind that transition? And one of the other things we had in mind while we were coming at this problem is that so often research about socioeconomic status and its relationship to healthcare or health use and health status has been to just address socioeconomic status or poverty as a single monolithic entity. That is, we know poverty drives health status. But taken as a whole, poverty as a social determinant of health can feel, especially to policymakers and politicians, it's just too big to move. It's too huge. Changing poverty or eliminating poverty would take a generation. And many of our politicians think in four-year life cycles. And so it's no real surprise that it's so hard to keep social determinants on the policy agenda. So our approach with this research was to break down socioeconomic status into its many components. We looked at income and education, of course. Those are, of course, some of the key indicators. But we also looked at things like neighborhood factors, like housing security, food security. So taken as discrete pieces, they start to feel like things that you can change, some more easily than others, and most importantly, things that we can actually change or work towards changing in a primary care setting. So what did we find? After crunching data on over 50,000 Ontarians, following them for 5 years, looking at all the various social factors, what we found was the number one single most important risk factor of somebody becoming a high-cost user of the healthcare system was their access to adequate, safe, nutritious food. Food security. It increases your risk of becoming a high-cost user by 50% if you are food insecure. And that is just for food insecurity. You add on income insecurity, and you're up that much higher. So the three highest determinants were food insecurity, second was income, no surprise, the third was housing security. All right? For me, this is incredibly important because these are things we can address. And in many cases, we can address them in primary care through innovative approaches. And many of you are already addressing these in your primary care organizations, though obviously we only represent a small part of the primary care going on in this province. But I think that there's very promising initiatives going on in many of the organizations that you represent. As just a single example, one organization I'm part of has hired a health promoter who specializes in income security, and she's having an enormous impact on the monthly income of her patients, and that is the second most important factor in somebody's risk of transitioning to high-cost use. Imagine if we could look at something like food security as well, where our primary care providers, our nurse practitioners, and our doctors were able to prescribe food security to their patients and have that delivered in the primary care setting. It could be an enormously powerful lever towards reducing high-cost use. And so this becomes a supplement where we understand some people will still become sick, and some people will still need an enormous amount of health care, and that care will need to be coordinated. But in the primary care setting, by being aware of the social determinants of high-cost use, we can make a meaningful impact, I believe, in reducing the overall burden on our healthcare system. So I could discuss the implications of this work at length and would be happy to in our discussion, but I'd like to get us to talking because there's a ton of really interesting panelists who I think have a lot of really interesting things to say. But I just want to wrap up by saying, for me, this work demonstrates the need for public health and community health to be integrated in with both primary and acute care if we're really serious about taking on and better serving the 1% and the 5% within the primary care environment. So thank you very much.
Thanks, André. Thanks, Jeremy. I want to invite our other panelists to come join us now. And while you're making your way up, I'll introduce you very briefly. These very short bios won't do justice to them, but we're trying to go quickly. So we have Jack McCarthy, Executive Director of Ottawa's Somerset West Community Health Center, one of the 9 CHCs in the Champlain-Lynn. Just developed a systematic plan to expand access to community health centers. Walking behind me now is Gloria Daybutch, Executive Director of the Nimiya Community Health Center, which serves 7 First Nations communities located along the shores of Lake Huron. And last but not least, Adrianna Tetley, who you all know as the CEO of the Association of Ontario Health Centers. So I'm going to sit down and bombard them with questions. and then we'll have some fun. So we'll see if this, this is working more or less, aside from the feedback. Okay, so Lynn, you've had a chance to catch your breath, so I'll put you on the spot first. So I want to ask you that sort of the elephant in the room question. So everyone here, very committed to community health centers, the primary care delivery in the community. You know, the feeling, and I've been talking to people all day, and I talk to them in my job, they say, listen, we've been doing a great job for 50 years or so. Why doesn't the ministry just embrace this model and expand it? Well, why do we have to keep reinventing the wheel?
That's the first question.
Yeah.
It's going to be that kind of panel.
Yeah. So I would say, in some ways, we would agree with you. I don't think we at all want to reinvent the wheel. I think that we already have some tremendous assets that we've created through the organizations that we already have. AHACs, FITs, community health centers, nurse practitioner-led clinics. I think all of them demonstrate how we can do innovation and do it well and really make a difference. I just think there are some foundational elements that we would all recognize have not really been there. So the connection of really clear accountability for who is accountable for that patient that's showing up in the ER that ought to be serviced in primary care. How we're beyond incenting the right behaviors. We've tried. We've got, I can't remember how many hundreds of payment models we might have in place for primary care. We're layering on new incentives and new models, and we're still not achieving the outcomes that we need. To some key indicators like same day, next day access, it seems so simple in concept, but we're just not there. It's also noteworthy that some of the models that are our most expensive, so where we've invested the most, actually we're performing the worst on those areas. So something's broken with how we're incenting and paying for the outcomes. So although we've come a long way, we're not there yet. The model that we're sort of contemplating absolutely does not blow up what's already there. It's really taking the tremendous interprofessional models that we've already created, trying to bring fee-for-service solo practitioner folks into the mix, and really looking at a group of people practicing in a certain way, together, so that they are collectively responsible for the health outcomes of that population. And them quarterbacking the system for the patient, being that single accountable person, group, whatever you want to call it, that's actually going to make sure the patient is navigated appropriately through the system.
But to ask you the flip side of that question, to let you off the hook a bit, you've got a whole bunch, a whole whack of conflicting demands every single day. It's hard, right? You're not just dealing with primary care. You have to fit this all into a bigger puzzle. How do you deal with that?
So we're trying not to just think of primary care as a single strategy. There's no question. You will all know that there are some other significant priorities that the ministry is dealing with, home and community care reform, and continuing the journey of quality in hospitals. We're not looking at this in isolation, and that's why when we sort of talk about primary care, we include health links in the conversation, we include home and community care in the conversation, and that crosses many different ADMs within the ministry, but I would say that there is definitely a coordinated approach to the way we're doing this. Sometimes that's the reason why I think people think, well, you know, we've been talking about this for months. When are we going to hear the implementation plan? When are we going to hear the details? When are we going to know the next steps? It's because we're trying to coordinate this across a single strategy for the ministry. We don't want to go out and do something for primary care that doesn't take into account the rest of what we've just heard about, home and community, public health, health links, et cetera.
Now, Jeremy, you talked about, you know, the number one of the big cost drivers, or the big three cost drivers, food insecurity, income insecurity, lack of housing. Some people in the general public, not in this room, but in the general public, say, hold on, that's not health. That's other stuff, right? That's the social safety net. How do we change the conversation to get people to realize that this is health and it's more important or as important as medical care?
If I had figured that out already, André, and then we'd make more progress.
You've got 30 seconds.
I mean, I think one of the things is, as an academic and as somebody that works in this area, I think one of the things we do need to do is change the language that we use around this when we're talking to members of the public. And I personally think that the social determinants of health, we all understand them in this room, but that term just sounds like academic jargon, I think, to an enormous number of people in the public. And I think one of the biggest ways, though, in terms of how we make that penetrate, in addition to changing the language, is to start telling stories. I think, and many of us already do, but to tell those stories that connect the dots for people, for members of the public and for politicians, to say, look, these things are all deeply interconnected, and I think many of our clients are precisely the kinds of people whose stories do connect those dots. For people, and I think that's incredibly important to get that message out and to let people meet our clients and hear their stories and understand how that social safety net has profoundly affected their health and how when we actually intervene and provide them with social supports, their health very frequently improves.
And I think you're right. I think medicine has done a really good job of telling stories about here's how someone is impacted, this is why this treatment helps them. They personalize it. And I think in this sector, haven't done that good a job. We talk about in more in academic terms. When I pitch these stories to my bosses, they say, oh, poor people are unhealthy. Well, tell me something I don't know. Of course they're unhealthy, they're poor. You know, it seems self-evident to people in the public, and so there has to be a new way of telling those stories.
I think what the point is, too, is I think that represents this sort of sense of, well, they're poor, so there's nothing we can do about it. And I think that's where we really need to change the conversation to say, actually, there really are a lot of things we can do about it. Some of them are very concrete, and some of them we can deliver in a primary care environment.
And Adrianna, your group has talked about this, you talk about this a lot. You have a new mission statement, in fact, that really focuses on reducing health disparities. How can you shift that conversation into the public? Talk to us a bit about that.
Well, I think there's a couple of things I want to respond to in addition to what was just said. And the one I want to pick up first is the food security question, because all of our community health centers and Aboriginal health access centers actually do programs in food security. It's about food mitigation. They provide healthy food baskets. They do community gardens. They help people to cook on limited budgets. And yet, most of our CHCs have to fundraise for the food to provide to the families. So it's not seen as core to what a community health center does, and yet we know if we actually did food security, we would actually change the health outcomes. A wonderful program is Four Villages, where they did a program, and there's many CHCs I could have used as an example, where there were pregnant moms who didn't have good food security. And through a program by providing healthy foods throughout the entire pregnancy and 2 years afterwards, they not only hit every single child ended up being a healthy weight, they also were breastfeeding during that time with the kind of supports, and it was all tied around food. But that CHC fundraises, because the Lynn nor the ministry funds that work. And many of our community health centers and Aboriginal health sectors aren't recognized for that work. So if we want to have change, make it in the accountability agreements, that policy that you should say, you've got complex and socially complex people, what are you doing to help them on food security? Do you know whether they have food security and what are the solutions? Then, and the reason isn't to hold the CHCs accountable, it's to hold the LINs accountable to the full scope of what a CHC does. So, food security is dear to the heart of almost everybody in this room, and the research we're so pleased to see that validates the work that we've been doing. But in terms of that mission statement of challenging the system, we really do in health equities and health disparities. I'm actually going to challenge Lynn on her last slide. When I saw your last slide go up and I saw what would be different for patients, I didn't see anything about determinants of health. I didn't see anything about health promotion. It was on the side, but usually when people think in the ministry at the moment, they think about healthy exercise and active living, but it's not fundamentally dealing with the determinants of health. And my challenge to you, because oftentimes, and you talked about it this morning, about scaling up, right? We're trying to fix everything that's broken. You've got a sector here, you've got multiple sectors in this room that are serving, should be serving 22% of the population. They are the most socially and medically complex people. We know that that 22% represents people in poverty, racialized, new immigrants, Aboriginal, Francophones, LGBT, people with mental health and addiction issues. If we could get a population needs-based plan for that 22%, find out where they are, and develop models that provide wraparound services, we will not only keep that 22% healthy, we'll prevent them from becoming that 5%. And I need to make just one more comment, because before lunch, I watched the Truth and Reconciliation Report, and this government must develop an Aboriginal primary health care plan. And it must start, it must include healing intergenerational trauma. I know Gloria is going to talk about this a little bit later. We need to change the trajectory for Aboriginal people in this province, and we need to allow the Aboriginal people to lead, guide, and transform and change the health direction of their people. And I think we need to be supporting that. And you've got a premier who's totally behind Aboriginal health. And so that's one of the transformational changes that would make a big difference. We know the stats for Aboriginal people in the province. We want to change it. Let's invest in the Aboriginal primary health care to change that trajectory.
And that's a perfect segue into Gloria. I want to ask you that. What, you know, we know that the health outcomes of Aboriginal communities are poor. People in this room know a lot of the reasons for that. But how can you ensure that we change primary care to address those specific needs? What has to be done, especially for the First Nations communities to flourish and to benefit from good primary care?
Thank you for the question. I'd like to, first of all, acknowledge that we do have boards of directors who are with our 10 AHACs, and there are several of them in the room now, and I want to acknowledge some of them are the survivors of the residential school system, and I want to first of all acknowledge them, as well as acknowledging the generational survivors, which I am one of them from the residential school system. And I think you alluded, Adrianna, to a really good study that was recently done with the Truth and Reconciliation Commission report. It is first and foremost our story, and it is our story to be told. And it is the responsibility of our Aboriginal health access centers and our Aboriginal leaders to design primary health care that includes traditional health and healing as an essential component of our services. With that responsibility, then it becomes our destiny to drive the accountability process, to show the evidence that if we can include healing as an essential part of our services, we can relate to higher improved health outcomes. But without that era of trying to deal with the trauma and the harm done by childhood experiences and how it's, as one of our great speaker, Mr. Martin Broken Leg says, what we don't transform, we will continue to transmit. And we have transmitted the whole history of our people, residential school included, but right from the gradual Civilization Act of 1867, where they tried to civilize us because they saw us uncivilized people. We were either savages or we were people who needed to be civilized, right down to the 1867 Indian Act that was really meant to get rid of the Indian problem by getting rid of the Indian people.
And you're seeing the impacts of that to this day.
Yes, we are. And it is our responsibility to design those healing programs ourselves. It is our story. We're all human. We all have that humanness within us, but we all have our story. And the truth and reconciliation is our story. And it is our right to design and develop our own healing programs that meet the needs of our Aboriginal people.
Now, Jack, I want to bring you in on the conversation. I was reading some interesting background material on the Champlain-Lynn, and what I was struck about is that the CHCs in your region have really banded together and gotten organized. I wonder if you could talk a bit about the benefits of that and how it's improved care, if it has. I'm assuming it has.
Okay, just for people, the Champlain-Lynn in the east, imagine 11 CHCs, 18 different sites. We meet, of course, monthly and talk about a number of issues around access and health equity. But we were in a discussion with our CEO, and we're talking about how do we improve access, and does each CHC have to go with a request? And we were challenged back by the CEO and said, well, let's come up with a comprehensive plan. So we got right to work. We did our homework. We put a data model together, and there's 34 sub-LINs within the Champlain-Lynn. And using the Ontario Marginalization Index and looking at health system utilization and access to primary care providers within those 34 sub-LINs, we very quickly got to a point where we could really identify where the hot spots were, where are the vulnerable people who needed access to primary care. And then we did work looking at internally at all the CHCs in Champlain and what did we need to come to the table to be able to deliver on that. And we looked at our panel size, we looked at the physical space we had, we looked at the ratio of clinical support staff to providers, we looked at making sure they were all were open 5 days a week and these kind of factors. So we really identified what we could bring to the table. So if we could bring this, and we knew where the folks were, in terms of providing access to unattached patients and so forth, we're ahead of the game. So now the conversation, André, is to have that discussion with the Lynn, saying we've done our work. Now, what can we do to leverage our resources into those areas where those patients are, that the clients are, that we can be providing support to? What can we leverage at our existing sites? Could we open satellites? Could we do a range of things to be able to provide comprehensive primary health care to the people who most need it in Champlain? So to me, it was a really good example of population health needs-based planning, which certainly is what we're talking about a lot today.
So I want to ask each of you, I was going to do this at the end, but I'm afraid I'll run out of time, so I'm going to jump right into that. I want to ask you, if each of you, if you could make one change to primary care today, because we're talking about reforming primary care, what would the one change be if the minister said, listen, I'm going to grant you your wish, I'm the genie, what's the one thing you could do today? Adrianna, what do you want to...
I think you should scale up what is working and plan for the 22%.
You don't have to be brief,
oh.
It's not the end.
Oh, there you go. Well, that's very good then. So scale up what is working. Just a really good example with the health links. I think that many of our stories are where there's health links, you're looking for that 5% of the people. What we're already seeing is that the people that were in many of our community health centers and Aboriginal health access centers, some of the other people in the area are scratching their heads and they're going, why aren't health link patients in CHCs? And, you know, I was saying this to Lynn over lunch. I'm saying, I would not expect a CHC patient to become a HealthLink patient because it is our mandate to do what HealthLink is trying to do. It is a mandate to provide comprehensive wraparound services that focus on the determinants of health. It is a revelation to many HealthLinks that poverty and food are the drivers for many of the people in HealthLinks. We already know that. So if our people are showing up in the frequency in as 5%, we should really look at it. Some of them are legitimate 5%, right? Not everybody's going to be prevented. But if it's a preventable thing, what can we do to turn that around? So in many cases, we need to scale up and find out who is already. And I'm sure the St. Mike's Project, Inner City Health Ontario, some nurse practitioner-led clinics, where are people already working? We don't have to change the whole system. Let's really start working with the where it's working and scale it up. To your point this morning, I have to say to Lynn this morning, in your slide you said in 2003 was the founding of team-based care, and I'm sure every single person in this room went again, because there we go. How many people did that, saw that slide? And I was going to sell Lynn quietly, but you know what? They're hitting their 40th and 50th anniversaries of doing team-based care in this province, and it always looks like it just was created in 2003. Right, so scaling up what's working, scaling up with the populations, the Aboriginal health access centers, and how can we build on that infrastructure to do more with what we already have. The other is the population needs-based planning. To the example that with Champlain, I actually would urge you to look at the 22%. Now, it might be a little bit higher. We did research, and we came with 22%. It might be 20, it might be 25. But these are all people who are on the trajectory for poor health outcomes. Right? If we can reach that 22% and who is working with them and are we doing the good things to keeping them healthy and well in the first place, that's how we'll slow down what is going down. So population needs-based planning with a health equity approach, focusing on the population who needs it the most, an Aboriginal health strategy, and also scaling up what's working. How's that?
That was a shopping list of more than one.
Okay. They're all related.
But Lynn's writing it all down.
Right.
Jeremy, I'll give you a chance to give your one wish, but talk a bit about that, because you alluded to this. Is health links and prime community health centers, are they integrated enough? Are they working at cross purposes? Are they working together?
I don't think they're working at cross purposes. I mean, I think many of the CHCs here are working hand in hand. In some cases, they're leading the health links. And You know, one of the things that they can do to not trip over each other is recognize that when a client is receiving care in a CHC, the care there is wraparound. But they often have specialist visits or acute care episodes, and there the health link can play an incredibly important role in coordinating all of that care and communication between the providers. So I think there's great opportunities for them to work in synergy, and I don't see one as replacing the need for the other. So much as to say that, as I think you're alluding to, this 25% who were not meeting their needs right now. If you're served by a community health center or an Aboriginal, all of our community health, governed primary care providers, then you're receiving these social determinants-based interventions. If you are not one of the 4% of Ontarians that have access to that, you're not. And so there's an enormous gap. And that definitely needs to be closed. Not every single person in Ontario needs the level of interventions we provide in these models, but many do.
Gloria, tell us your wish. If you could change one thing to improve primary care for your clientele, what would it be?
I guess, first of all, I want to clarify, when I said we needed to, we had the right to design our own healing programs, we do it in partnership. We work very closely with our local hospitals, our public health units, CCACs, our Red Cross, Alzheimer's. We work with a lot of organizations, so we do believe in the coordination. I think if I had one wish, it would be to really ensure that we were adequately resourced, for number one. We're not as resourced, even though we're compared to community health centers. We don't reach that level of funding level. That would be one of the first steps we'd like to see. But to ensure that we can design healing, traditional health and real healing programs, and be adequately resourced to provide that healing that so many of our Aboriginal people need as a result of, again, residential school being one of them, but some real risk factors that associate our poor health. And looking at equity and equality, I like the definition I heard, very simple definition of equality was giving everyone a shoe. The definition of equity is making sure everyone gets a shoe that fits. I mean, it worked for Cinderella, so I guess it can work for us.
and give me a practical example of what's a healing program?
We've instituted in our health center a Beauty for Ashes program. It's an intensive program, 5-day program, in which our community members are able to look at a lot of the trauma and hurt that has been a result of childhood experiences. That can relate to everything from, of course, the common sexual abuse, physical abuse, emotional abuse, but we also look at things in our community such as household abuse. We're known for great parties we have on weekends, and they can last all weekend, and our poor child growing up in that type of atmosphere. We have a lot of incarcerated household members. Our incarceration rates are very high. So we have households where there's incarceration rates. We have divorce. We have young kids who have experienced their mothers being treated violently. And there's been a lot of harm, and that leaves a child, you know, just really looking at the horror stories that they can tell. It makes them feeling very intense fear that they have, as well as that feeling of hopelessness. And getting a program that, such as a Beauty for Ashes, really lets us look into those healing things. And one of the greatest things about the Beauty for Ashes, it's those who have been harmed have also caused harm. And I can relate to my own mother, who was in residential school most of her life. And we were able to understand as her kids the intellectual part, the cognitive, the mental health issues of, yes, this is the way she is, that's why she could never hold us, and that's why she didn't like any physical contact with her kids. And we understood that intellectually, but we also had to understand it from our hearts and really truly understand the shame that she had to experience and how it affected our relational style with our children. I like to think I did a good job on my kids until they called me a very cold mother at one time. So I start thinking, you know, there are the relational styles that really have to be healed. And I think that's with our population that we will continue to transmit until we can transform. And healing is really transformational healing. And trauma informed primary care is critical to the Aboriginal population.
Jack, what's the thing you would do to improve primary care?
There's a couple of things. And to be very practical, certainly the number one recommendation that came out of our report is fix the problem of compensation for nurse practitioners. And fix it now. And I think that's something that can be done. I mean, it is crazy to me that within our sector, within the primary care sector, you have such disparities on how we pay nurse practitioners. If our sector, as in CHCs and AHACs, start to hemorrhage NPs, we're going to be dropping service to the most vulnerable population. At our health center at Somerset West, our NPs, as I'm sure this is replicated across the province, are doing amazing work. And doing such things as going into rooming houses and doing wound care and, you know, getting clean needles to people and linking with the health system. That's the service that's going to be cut if we don't address this horrible inequity situation we have on the compensation for nurse practitioners. And that's something that should be done immediately, not another 6-month study of more data. That's my first one.
Just to interrupt you, because I think most people in the room know this, but there's like a pay differential of $20,000, $30,000 if you're a nurse practitioner in the community or in a hospital, right? That's the issue.
That's correct, and Adrianna may know more details on that.
Yeah, an RN with a few years of experience gets paid more in a hospital than a nurse practitioner with 40 years experience. We've had nurse practitioners who were the CHCs were the first model to bring in CHCs, and they are earning $89,000 and have been receiving that for like 20 years, and they have had no increase. They could go to a community health access center, they could go to public health, they go to hospitals, and they'll be immediately paid $120,000 to $130,000. So we're trying to get, and the competition is pretty fierce right now because we're seeing more and more nurse practitioners being absorbed in other places. We're trying and advocating as part of our strategy. It's a minimalist strategy. We're trying to move them from 89 to start to 103. So it's not even a competitive with their partners, and yet that's still about 2.5% less than a family physician. And you have to understand, in our models, and almost everyone in this room, a nurse practitioner and a physician do the exact same work to the same scope, with the small exception of being able to do narcotic prescribing. But other than that, our nurse practitioners do, you know, totally work to full scope and totally do the same kind of service. So it is so critical. And there's others in the same room, and I'd be bereft to not add the dietitians who have not been in their health in the correct band for many, many years, and all the other staff who have been frozen for a number of years as well, because as a non-unionized sector, most CHCs aren't, and AHACs aren't unionized, and so have been under the freeze for a long time. And also, you know, from system change, might as well finish, throw the last one in. You know, we are funded, everybody in this room is funded at 20% benefits. We're advocating for a modest increase to 22.5. You tell me a hospital, a public health unit, a CCAC that is offering benefits at 22.5 and getting into HOOP. And we're saying for 2.5 more, we can get into HOOP. If we want to do system transformation, we need to allow people to take their pensions with them when they move from hospitals to our sectors, from public health or from CCACs to our sector. Because in many cases, and we have lots of examples, people are willing to take a cut in pay to come and work in our models, but not if they leave their pension behind.
So Lynn, I'll come back to your 1B. But Lynn, just to be fair, I know that I've heard the minister address this, and he says he's trying to deal with this issue. And there is, again, some complication. There's labor contracts are one of the biggest problems in healthcare and dealing with. So, just to be fair, this is being dealt with, right?
Yes.
It's on the radar for sure.
It's definitely on the radar. I would like to echo, you know, my support for this. I think we all feel the same way. It's definitely been recognized. And it's, I would say, all members of the interprofessional teams, not just nurse practitioners, but I think our recruitment challenges with nurse practitioners is sort of what raised it to the top. We know there are issues around some of the directives, as you know, and some of the labor issues. But it, I think it's, I would say, the minister is really trying to push hard on it, so I think you have his support. So you have the ministry's support. It's just a matter of trying to navigate it.
The devil's in the details.
The devil's in the details.
Great. So Jack, 1B.
Well, 1B for me is community health workers. And it goes right to the whole question of food security and employment support. If we are truly going to embrace the social determinants, we need resources at our CHCs. And if we could flood our system with community health workers who could do that work, then I think we'd make incredible gains to build on the amazing work that's happening now. And whether, like I say, it's employment support programs or food security, there's a whole range of issues, advocating for affordable housing. But it's also bringing people together at a local level. Civil society flourishes when you have, you know, community workers, resourcing advocacy committees, of boards of directors, of community health centers. So we're talking about these issues, and we're coming up with very specific kinds of plans in our communities to address them. And I think that's where the passion is, that's where the energy is, that's where the excitement is, that we can, that really builds the hope that you can truly make a difference. And I think that's a precious resource, and I think we really need it. I'm mindful of, and I got to make this little segue. I was in a discussion with other executive directors in Ottawa when Deb Matthews came, and she was talking about the anti-poverty strategy that the province is rolling out. And it was a good discussion, and I have tremendous respect for Deb Matthews, certainly as a former health minister and a key minister within this government. And she said something which didn't surprise me, but which was certainly discouraging. She said, you know, when we try to engage the federal government on talking about anti-poverty issues, they will not talk to us. The federal government in this country will not talk to the province of Ontario about anti-poverty strategies. So I'm going to, my bold statement to be made here in front of everybody is, on October the 19th, we've got to get rid of the current government, federal government in Canada. So, yeah.
So, see, we're taking a little heat off the province now. Well, throw it on the feds, that's great. Jeremy, what I'm hearing over and over between the lines is we make this artificial distinction between health and welfare, for lack of a better term. I've been around long enough that when I started, there was a federal department of health and welfare. Is that the nub of the problem, is that we make this artificial distinction? They're really one and the same?
Yeah, absolutely. Do you want more than a one-word answer?
Sure. Feel free to expand.
I don't even really have much more to say than that. Yeah, I mean, it's an artificial distinction. I thought you were going to ask me about what the one thing I would change.
Well, you can answer whatever you want to.
I'll do the thing you do in the media when you answer the question you want at.
I wish
you were asked. So I'm going to take off my kind of researcher hat and put on my little policy analyst hat and just say something. And this is not to speak to actually the people in this room, but to the other 98% of primary health care providers in the province, which is, I think that we need to shift our discussion from talking about incentives with them and chasing incentives over and over, and we never seem to find the right group of incentives, and frankly, half the time, primary care practitioners don't even know what incentives, what behavior the incentives are supposed to motivate, and start talking about accountability with them. And it's something this sector's moved towards. It's been tough as a board member. Oh man, I see a lot of red, yellow, green stoplights, dashboards, and I know it's very rough sometimes with the accountability, but frankly, as somebody that then sees primary care providers in non-community governed fits, I see them reacting much more to seeing what their rates are in terms of, you know, repeat ED visits and visits at the ED that were inappropriate. That motivates them way more than a bunch of incentives which they kinda sorta understand. And I just think that not only is that essential, that we need accountability from a public, just a public governance point of view, but I just think it's a much more powerful lever as we look towards primary care transformation for the other 98% of primary care in this province.
Great. So we're almost out of time. And so Lynn, you're here, you've taken a lot of this flack, so I want to give you the last word. I want you to turn the tables and tell this sector, tell community health centers and other similarly named institutions. What can they do differently to make it easier for you to fix primary care?
Well, I'll answer that in two ways, because I want to give my number one thing that I would change, but it's going to sort of be along the same lines. I would have said, had you asked me, that I would really like to see a time where we actually fund a group of providers in a certain region appropriately for taking care of, but also the health status of a certain population that they're accountable for. We don't dictate how they do it, so they can do whatever needs to be done. There's no buckets of money that you can only spend on certain things, but instead we appropriately resource the providers and the community, and then we don't have to deal with the details, because there are no incentives and bonuses and us trying to sort of finagle what's happening, but that the sector is truly accountable for what they need to do, and it's not about what bonus they get and, you know, how they're incented. And they're accountable, and we have great metrics to demonstrate it, and everyone understands them, and everyone is truly committed to achieving them, and the metrics are completely patient-centered. It's not about the providers, it's about the patients and what they need, no matter what they need. If I could do one thing, if I could have one thing, that would be it, because we don't want to be up there dictating how things are done and what money you can spend and what providers you need and can you have a secretary or is it better to have a physio? And we don't want to do that. We want to say, here's the money we think you need. Tell us if it's about right. Go do it. That would be my perfect scenario for me personally. So what I would say is, how do we need to get there? When we're out talking about, I'm out there all the time saying the primary sector wants this accountability. They want it. This is not about us driving down accountability or giving it to someone who doesn't want it or doing something different. They want it. So I guess what I would ask is, hopefully you do, because any of the folks I've talked to, it appears that that's what you want. And I guess you saying it as well, you being on the bus with us to say that, yeah, we're willing to look at the data, we're willing to make the hard decisions, we're willing to improve performance, we're willing to acknowledge that, yep, we're just as accountable as the hospital for 30-day readmit rates, for example, and we're going to take it on. So that's what I would challenge, and if that's the case, and that's what we keep saying, that they want it, then we have to step up and do it.
So I know we could have this discussion for at least another hour, but we want to leave you wanting, so you'll come back for more next year. So should I take questions? Yeah, okay. Okay, sorry, I understood that I had to wrap up, but I want to take a couple of questions from the floor. I thought they were cutting that off, but my mistake. So let's get a couple of questions in from you guys. I got caught up in it. I want to hog the limelight once again. So let's go here. I can barely see, but at this mic, whatever number it is.
Okay, to build on some of the comments that have been made, Trillium Foundation for many years has been funding a lot of wonderful initiatives, and being responsive in the distribution of resources, they have come up with a new type of funding where we are looking at to grow your initiative, right? And this year they are rolling out this new funding strategy. I have been, in fact, June is giving me 5 years since I have been coming to this conference. And I have been hearing a lot about best practices. I have seen so many by sitting in different workshops of programs that have been implemented on a community-based level. And my question is, what is the Lean or even the Ministry of Health doing to ensure that some of the best practices that have been developed, that they are sustainable and that they can get co-funding? I think this is something that is critical. We need to look at the distribution of our resources and how we are able to maintain some of the things, that ideas that came up when we're looking at food security, when we're looking at innovative programs that have been implemented, how are they being sustained?
So Lynn, do you want to talk about how can you promote best practices?
Yeah. It seems so simple, but it's not. I think that clinicians were trained. I am a former clinician. I haven't practiced in a long time, but I would like to say that we are trained to practice in an evidence-based way, and where we see that there's best practice identified and that achieves a better outcome for a patient, that better be what we're doing. I think you're probably talking about a little bit more broadly, where perhaps in a there's models that are best practice, or there's more team-based best practice initiatives. I think that there's probably a lot of work that your sector can do, and the associations that you have, and driving. I mean, it doesn't work to have sort of us on high, sort of saying, well, now we're going to again, we don't want to get into funding incentives and trying to pull funding levers. Well, if you're practicing in this model that's now evidence-based, we're gonna reward you, or we're gonna take money away if you don't. I think that the sector itself and the associations that are quite strong, driving some of the best practice work and making sure that the collective, and all I'm gonna say the sector, the primary care sector as a collective, is driving this together. In my experience in driving best practice in sector change or in provincial change, it has to be the sector itself moving it forward. Someone telling you to do it traditionally, I've seen, doesn't really work. The funding, like as I said, if we're really designing a system that has sort of population-based funding, then it should be up to the sector to determine, well, how to best utilize that funding to achieve the best outcomes for the patients. You're going to have to use the models that promote best practice and evidence-based practice if that's going to work.
So Adrianna, jump in there.
Yeah, I want to talk from the Lynn's perspective. And I think that one of the biggest problems that we still have with the Lynn's is that in many cases, the Lynn's are funded to treat sickness. I've talked to Lynn CEOs who would love to be able to talk about health, but their accountabilities with the ministry is on metrics related to the hospital and the sickness side. How does that then feed down? The CHCs, their metrics that they're held accountable for are metrics related to primary care in the narrowest sense of the world. So if we want to change, and you know, no problem best practices, this is a very united sector. They can share best practices. They're the first ones on the bus on any best practice. The issue is allowing that and recognizing it, the Lynn's, and between the Lynn's and the ministry. The ministry does not say to the Lynn's, what are your members doing on health equity? What are your members doing to keeping people healthy? They don't even ask who our partners are, yet their name is Lynn Local Health Integrated Networks, and yet the CHCs, by choice, provide the list of their partners to the Lynn's. The Lynn's don't ask. So what the Lynn's are interested in will send a signal to what's important, right, and where you put your energies. And so we need to expand that accountability agreement. Accountability, the CHCs, the majority of the people, the AHACs in the early days, the nurse practitioners and the FITs, you've got early days for this. We need to change what they're being held accountable for. That will drive behavior. And right now, you know, you could ask, I'm sure there's health promoters and community workers in this room, in the accountability agreement, their work is missing.
So I would agree with that. So if I can just comment back, I would agree with that, and I think that there's nobody that would disagree with you that we have to do a better job at aligning the accountability agreements and the metrics and the conversations we're having with Lynn's. And just like we've talked about strengthening primary care, we need to strengthen what we do with the Lynn's and give them the tools that they need to manage. So I would support your comments.
So let's go back to microphone 3. Yep. Go ahead.
Jeremy, this thing with the statistical association that because food security is the best predictor, I think is at best naive and at worst dangerous. You basically are saying we can't do anything about poverty, so we're going to do food security. And I'd make 2 points. One, no, you did. You said the governments are not interested in doing poverty, so we'll do food insecurity. Well, no less authorities than Lynn McIntyre and Val Tarasuk have said that community kitchens, while they're worth doing, community kitchens, food banks, food stamps, they're not the solution. And the belief that if you provided people with food security and kept them on low income, bad housing, crappy jobs is going to make them healthier is naive. It's dangerous because you basically say to the ministry person there and to all of you people, we can't do anything about poverty. The social justice premier can't do anything about making it easy to unionize. She can't do anything about raising the minimum wage. She can't do anything. When Deb Matthews was in opposition, she wrote a 300-page report that said social assistance program was a disgrace. And once she gets into cabinet, she does nothing. So again, statistically showing that food insecurity is a predictor of health, and therefore we focus on food insecurity, period, which is what you said. We can't do anything about poverty, I think is not the kind of message you want these concerned activists, healthcare providers to walk away with. We can't do stuff about poverty, and I don't think it's your job to let the provincial government off the hook.
So, Jeremy, I'm gonna ask you to answer, but I forgot to, when you come to the mic, introduce yourself. This is Dr. Dennis Raphael from York University. I recognize the voice, even though I can't see him. So, Jeremy, go ahead.
Yeah, so my comments are obviously not meant to say that we can't do or shouldn't do anything about poverty. Indeed, I think I said there were three primary drivers that we see, and that those are things that we can, in fact, intervene on in within the context of primary care, and that I would like to see those become things which, instead of just seeing intervened on within the organizations in this room, that we're seeing much more broadly deployed throughout primary care, that we're looking at how somebody's housing security and, in fact, their income level, which is the second highest predictor, and yes, food security. And I think the fact that food security is such a strong predictor and that we saw it across the board where we looked suggests exactly that food stamps and all that kind of stuff are fundamentally not working. If they were, then we wouldn't have seen food security as such a massive problem in our study. And do we need to work towards poverty alleviation on a provincial scale? Absolutely. But I think to a great degree, and I think your example of Deb Matthews perhaps a good one, it doesn't happen once politicians get into office. And those of us who are in the civil service and who have a responsibility to take action, one of the things that I hope that our study does is show that we can take action at the level of our organizations that can make meaningful difference for people's lives and their health status.
Gloria, I wondered if you could jump in here. On this issue of poverty, how do you address poverty in Aboriginal communities without perpetuating these stereotypes of everybody being poor and not having hope? How do you balance that?
I guess poverty is definitely a social issue within many of our First Nation populations in our communities. But I think it's more than just poverty, it's the whole issue, and I'm going to go back again to healing. Like, you could perhaps give us money, you could do things, but are we going to make good decisions? I don't know. Until we start dealing with some of those real social problems that we have that comes from real healing of our nations and our people, poverty is just one of these other issues that we have, poor education, poor health, and we can design good quality water, right? Good quality water where it's not smelling like petroleum when you run your water. It's one of the very many social indicators of good health, but we really do need to start addressing the healing of our nations that have been the heart of our problems lies within our stories.
So I'm told we have time for one really quick question from microphone one. So go ahead, but it has to be really a punchy one. Okay.
I need a mic. Yeah. There we go. I'm Sheila Bradick from the Region Park Community Health Center. Thank you to all the panelists for your comments, and thank you, Adrianna, for responding to some of the concerns that I had, actually, in the comments that were made earlier. So much to question. One comment that I have, I think, and I will be brief, one is that I'm very aware that we're having the conversation about reforming primary health care within the box that we've already created for ourselves. And at some point, we need to figure out how to get out of that box and look at how are we going to talk about promoting health in this community. And I think Jack's comment about community health workers was a first step in that direction. So thank you for that. The one question I have at this point is, with respect to health links, Lynn, you mentioned rostering people to health links. I'm one of those people that actually believes in the idea that health links aren't a thing, they're a way of working together. So help me understand your comment. Yeah. Thanks.
So I don't mean roster with a capital R. that's why I was using it sort of as if you can envision what this could look like for a population in a community. Instead of if I'm lucky enough to live in a certain community, I might have access to a health link that's actually giving me this great coordination of services and access to an interprofessional team and all these great things. In some communities, I might not have that at all, or I might have a health link that's not quite what I need based on my situation. What I was trying to get across is that can you envision a time, and let's just use the word roster as a word to describe that I belong to a certain primary care practice or group or FIT or CHC, or I belong there. Maybe I'm rostered, maybe I'm not, but that's my provider that I feel attached to. I would also like to see a time where if I am one of those people that requires complex, coordinated care that's across several sectors, that I automatically have access to something like a health link. Right now they're called health links, but no matter where I'm attached with my primary care provider, I would like to have access to that type of sort of high quality coordinated care automatically. I don't have to go find it. My providers are actually saying, oh, there's someone based on, you know, what the conversations we're having with that person who actually needs navigation and needs coordinated care beyond sort of the normal, what we're right now calling the 1% to 5% and however you want to characterize that group, which I do believe we need another phrase for, that I automatically get that as part of my attachment to that group, and that I don't have to know what it is or how to get it. They identify that, yeah, here's something that you need. So that's what I meant by rostered, meaning I don't have to go out and seek it. I automatically have access to that type of coordinated care just because I happen to be part of that practice or the group or provider.
And thank you, everyone, for your questions. I'm sorry, I forgot my timesheet on the table. I almost forgot to getting your questions in, but they were great. I'm going to invite Farley up to say some goodbyes, but while he's making his way up, please join me in thanking Lynn, Jeremy, Jack, Gloria, and Adrianna.